which I did not have control. These are all maybe valid reason, legitimate points. But I think a fearless leader is somebody who's able to take on that responsibility to say, yes, it happened in my watch, and therefore I take responsibility for it. Yeah, just like you would take probably credit for some of the good things that have happened, to also be able to take the responsibility for saying, yeah, this did not happen, and it is something where the buck stops with me. Which again relates to the next point, which is about really leading from the front, right? And here again, it is about saying, am I able to go into spaces where we haven't gone before? Because like one wise man said, if you did the same thing again and again and expect different results, that's not going to happen. That's insanity, right? That's really the definition of insanity, where doing the same thing again and again is not going to give you different results. So therefore, it is about saying...
Rajesh, are you using your presentation? Because we are only on the first slide. Are you using the slides? Because
I'm very much on the first slide. I'm talking to the fifth point on the first slide.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. So leading from the front is all about, therefore, you know, being able to say that, look, this is how we would like to go. I'm willing to walk with you, and let's go together and make this happen. Which again, the last point there, which is about go where no one has gone before. And very often this leading from the front would also warrant getting into spaces and territories where we have not ventured as an organization before. For example, are you entering into a new category? Are you entering into a new geography? Are you going to be trying a new way of doing something? And these are all things that one hasn't done before, and therefore requires a certain level of courage, a certain level of conviction and belief as we step out into these areas, right? So really, these are some of the values of a fearless leader, which I think are important to have. And that helps one to therefore become or go forward on this journey of fearless leadership. Any thoughts, questions so far?
So we'll urge everyone to use the chat, because we've actually muted everybody, because there could be a lot of static coming across. So we'd urge all the participants to actually write any questions if they have, so that I can, you know, sort of then relay it back to Rajesh. So somebody said not required right now, so we can move ahead, Rajesh.
All right, sounds good. Okay, so having seen what are some of the values of fearless leader, let's look at why do we need fearless leaders in the first place, right? I mean, we have leaders and we have leaders. Why can't we just manage with them? If you really look at it, I mean, this is an oft-used phrase, and I'm going to use it here as well, to say that I think today's environment, and particularly if you look at India today, and if you look around what is happening around us, I think it's extremely volatile. A lot of uncertainty around us. The complexity is only going up, and the ambiguity has always been there, right? So it is an environment where there are several macro factors at play, and many of them beyond our control. It started with, you know, demonetization a few years ago. GST came in along the way. The Modi government has come back. And even as we speak, there are several things happening in the outside world where really we have very little control over, right? So one of the key things is, in this kind of an environment, yeah, how is a leader able to sort of have a very clear sense of purpose and direction in which he or she wants to take the company?
So Rajesh, we're just seeing the title slide as of now. We're not able to see your other slides.
Really?
Yeah. So in fact, that's why I had asked you. So
oh, okay.
If you're still showing as a title slide, if you on which slide are you? People are also messaging on the chat.
Okay, I'm on slide 2, which says, why do we need fearless leaders? Slide 3, probably.
No, it's still showing the title slide right now to all of us.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, hold on 1 second. Maybe, yeah. Is it not working? Apologies for that. Huh? Sorry, 1 second. You mean it's still showing you just the first slide?
Yeah, just the title slide. Yeah.
Okay, hold on 1 second. Because I am sharing it.
Maybe we should close it and reshare it again, maybe.
Just 1 second, no?
Yeah. woman who is saying that maybe you have two screen windows. Reject that.
Yeah, okay. Just one second. Okay, I'm just going to get some IT support to help me with this. Just give me 1 second. Huh?
Yeah. Rajesh, do you want me to share the screen till then?
That's okay. I've got somebody here. Just give me a second.
Okay, sure.
Share karna hai, isme share nahi ho raha.
Ye share karna
hai. Ye share karna
hai. You share.
Hello. Main share to kiya tha वैसे.
Screen.
Yes, screen kar do. Basically, ye presentation kya share karna hai. Ya stop karke dobara karna. Is it now changing?
No, we're still on the rattle side.
No, change nahi ho raha.
Rajesh, we have the presentation. Should we share it? That will be better, I think.
Okay, do that. Do that.
Nikita, you have it, right? Could you share it, please? You have to then, you know, close your sharing.
Okay, I'll do stop sharing. Yeah, I'm out of sharing.
Yes. Nikita, would you be able to share it?
Yeah, I'm just doing that.
Good. Okay, just let me know when you have done it. Huh?
Is it visible to everybody now?
Yeah. We'll move to the next slide. Yes. So Rajesh, should we be on the second slide or the third slide?
Okay. So thanks. So what we'll do is, let me just go. So I'll have to speak to Nikita to do the moving of the slides, right?
She's online, so just tell and then she will press the button.
That's fine. So basically, if you go back two charts, Nikita, that's fine. So this is the one which I was speaking about, right? Over the last 10 minutes where I didn't realize that you guys didn't have this chart in front of you, but the basic points I was making in terms of values were around vulnerability, authenticity, resilience, taking responsibility, leading from the front, and really going to places where no one has gone before. So we spoke about that. If you move to the next chart, I was just talking about the VUCA world where there are so many things happening which are beyond our control, and therefore it is very important as a leader to look at how one could clearly have a clear defined sense of purpose and vision, and then ability to sift through all the noise in terms of what's happening around and make sure that we are able to make the right choices to take the organization forward in the right direction. Yeah. So I think that's a extremely critical reason why we need good leaders, because again, going back to the same point, if you were to keep doing the things that we have been doing in the past, that's not going to get us to where we would like to go in the future. So that's one reason of propelling the company in the right strategic direction. I think the second point is around how can, having a fearless leader, what it does is it continuously inspires teams to raise the bar. Again, this is the point which I was speaking about earlier, and I'm going back to that same point, which is that you have a bunch of people who together make up the organization, right? And if as a leader, you're able to chart the right course and show people the direction in which we would like to go. And very often it is a place where we have not been to before. It just makes them inspired to constantly raise the bar in terms of search of excellence, right? So I think that's a second reason why it would be great to have fearless leaders in any organization. And the third bit, I think, is around really building a culture of experimentation, right? Encouraging people to experiment, encouraging them to learn from that. And as a consequence, the individual grows and the organization grows as well. So, you know, one of the things that we also try and inculcate in people is you try, you might fail, but then let's fail fast and fail better. So every time you fail, we are able to quickly realize that things are not happening. We fail fast and pick it up from there. And we also fail better, meaning the next time I fail, I would have learned something more than this time, and therefore I'm able to fail better, right? So I think it's important to also make sure that we are in the constant mode of doing stuff for the first time, learning from that and growing as a consequence, right? So just to summarize, three reasons why it would be good to have fearless leaders, so that we are able to steer the organization in the right direction into spaces which we might not have gone to before. It continuously raises the bar in terms of search for excellence for the organization, and also builds a culture where there is a lot of experimentation, learning and growth, and a lot of value attached to that. Nikita, if you could move to the next slide. And which brings me to the last section in terms of what I wanted to share. This is around some of the habit. I mean, one could talk about this forever, and there are many, many traits and characteristics of fearless leaders. But I thought, let me pick three, which sort of at least resonate with me at a personal level, and share those with you. So one is doing what is right for the long term, even if it means sacrificing the short term, right? I think that's a very, very important thing. And I'll talk about each of them in a little detail with a couple of examples. The second one is really about operating from a proactive space rather than a reactive space. Yeah. And the third, how can one constantly push ourselves to, and others actually, to get out of comfort zone? Yeah. So I would say these are, in my mind, three critical habits. That's not to say that there are not others, but some ones which I thought I should call out as some things that have worked for me personally. Nikita, if you could move to the next chart. Yeah. So the first one we spoke about was, you know, fearless leaders do what's right for the long term, even if it means sacrificing for the short term. What do I mean by that? You know, I think life is full of trade-offs, right? And when I say life, it's life in general, but also work, where we are constantly faced with various options, and it's all about trade-offs. So one of the critical things for fearless leaders is their ability to do what is right for the long term. So they keep in mind the medium and long term and do the structurally the right thing to do for that, even if it means, or even if it comes at a cost of the short term, or if there is short-term pain that one has to experience. So I'll just give you an example. We have three factories in India, Chennai being one of them. A year and a half ago, we went through a pretty serious strike in the Chennai plant, where the union was going through a strike because they wanted certain things. Yeah. And it actually acted as a huge dampener, because, you know, we were right in the middle of a fantastic growth momentum. Things were going well. Business was doing well. And this sort of put a brake on the whole thing, because the production pretty much stopped. As a result, the sales got impacted, and obviously the business momentum was lost. But as a management team, we were very clear that, you know, look, what we were asking for was the right thing to do. And we were absolutely convinced of that. We had taken opinion from various other people. And we felt that certain things in the factory, in the areas of discipline, in the areas of hygiene, etc., are absolutely non-negotiable. And therefore, our whole intent was to say that, look, these are the right things to do. we will communicate that in the right manner to the people concerned and make sure that we are able to secure these for the long-term interest of the company. And if that meant suffering in the short term, so be it. And eventually it took almost 4 months for the strike to get resolved. And we, at the end of it, we came out in such a way that we got almost everything that we wanted signed off. And when I say everything we wanted, I meant more in terms of discipline, hygiene, and so on and so forth. And it was a win-win situation for all. But I think what this illustrates is that sometimes what happens is the pain of the short term makes us take some decision which might be detrimental to the long term. And one of the habits of a fearless leader is their ability to be very mindful of this and take a decision which takes the company or the organization in the right path from a long-term building of business point of view.
So Rajesh, I have a question for you.
Yeah.
This actually means a lot of patience and resilience. So how does one build that? I mean, you know, because there is always this conflicting pointers coming in saying that we have to, you know, sort of end up close this thing, close the situation and wait. So how does one develop that as a leader?
Yeah. See, Rashmi, unfortunately, I don't have a formula for that. But, you know, I think a few pointers. One, like I said, it's important for all of us to sort of try and over the years cultivate a little bit of a strategic mindset, right? Which then at least tells us that structurally, this is how I would like to take my business. And it doesn't have to be just for an MD sitting on top and running a business. It could be for each of us in our own areas of work. Whether you are a brand manager running a brand, whether you are an HR person running a department or whatever, right? I think having a little bit of an ability to look at the big picture to say that if I want to move my function or business from here to X to Y over a period of time, what are the things that I need to do, right? Which would make me succeed. And then those become your non-negotiables in terms of critical reasons for success. Right? I think that's one very important thing. The other is to have a collective alignment amongst the key stakeholders. So for example, even when we were going through this strike, it was very important for us to operate as a team. So the three or four people who were involved in this, we used to literally meet twice every day just to make sure that we are absolutely aligned on what we want to achieve. It was also very important to align above with people who are not sitting in the country or not who are responsible for the business. And it is also important to also, the third thing is effectively communicate. Yeah. Because what happens is very often people come and say, boss, why are we going through this? Let's just do this and get over with it. But our ability to effectively communicate that by doing this, this is what we are trying to achieve also makes people see the big picture. So I would say strategic mindset, managing and aligning expectations, and effective communication in a timely manner would be some ways of getting to this, develop this habit. I hope that sort of answers your question.
Yes, it does. So strategic thinking and ability to look beyond as a big picture and alignment, of course. There's another interesting question on the same point. It says, earlier in your talk, you spoke about purpose. What if one's personal purpose doesn't align with the organization's purpose? Does it always necessarily align? In case that it doesn't, what should one do?
No, that's a good question. I think, we spoke about purpose recently in some other context. I think the way it works is, of course, every organization has a sense of purpose, which is a larger purpose. And as a individual, all of us hopefully have one or have started working on some sort of purpose. And I am no different. I have one as well. Ideally, what you look for is, it's just like you look for compatibility with people, right? I mean, you tend to connect better with people who have a sense of purpose, which is more or less in the same space as you have, or a set of values which they hold dear, which is similar to what you have. So I think it's no different here. Ideal would be if there is a great element of congruence between your purpose and the organization's purpose, but that always doesn't happen. And in which case, as long as the values match, Now, if the values fundamentally don't match, then there is a little bit more of a problem, right? I mean, if the values I stand for are not in line with what the organization values are, then obviously maybe you need to rethink whether it is indeed the right fit for both parties. But otherwise, I think if the values are aligned, a purpose, it would be good to be aligned, but it's not like a must have.
Okay. Thank you. We can move ahead.
All right. So if you could move to the next one.
So there's another question, Rajesh, before we move on. Being leaders, irrespective at what capacity, we're surrounded by a team. Many times you've seen they go by popular opinion rather than thinking about if it's right or wrong. Do you see that often in organizations? It's a question from Hema.
Right. No, all the time. I think, especially in India, right, there is a lot of, so for example, I had a Dutch boss and, you know, they are, just to make a cultural point, they are very black and white. I mean, if he felt a certain way about something, he would be very, very clear in saying that, right? Irrespective of course, he would say it in a nice manner, but it was very clear that he had a point of view to share and he shares that point of view. Whereas in India, and I'm sorry, I don't mean to generalize, but we tend to be a little bit more seeking of popular opinion and making sure that as many people are happy, etc., which is fine. But I think when it comes to leadership, one of the most important things is, I think it's about making choices. And in making choices, it's always about trade-offs, right? So we have a responsibility as a leader to say, what is the right thing to do from a larger good point of view? And if that means being unpopular, if that means being not necessarily liked by a certain bunch of people, so be it. But I think that's our job. Ultimately, I think definitely, bless you, whoever that was. Ultimately, as a leader, I think one would like to definitely earn the love and respect of people. And by doing some of these, actually contrary to popular opinion, you would earn more love and respect by being true to what you stand for rather than pandering to popular opinion.
Yes, that makes sense. We can move on.
Yeah, so, you know, I spoke about the first one in terms of long term versus short term. I think the second point I sort of wanted to touch upon is, as much as possible, how we can operate from a proactive space than from a reactive space. You know, the way our brain is wired, I mean, the minute it confronts fear or something which is like a threat, right? There are three kinds of things that can happen. Either we fight it back, or we run away from it, or we just freeze into inaction, right? So typically, these are the kind of responses that happen whenever we are confronted with something which we are not comfortable with. And I am no different. I mean, that was how it was in my early years of my career. But I think over the years, one of the things I've learned is to say that, you know, very often when you're confronted with something which is not in your comfort zone, which is you're not comfortable with, I think a good thing to do is to find a way to have a composed response to it, right? And I think that really helps you in then taking the right kind of decision at that point of time. Of course, if you have the luxury of time, then that's even better. But otherwise, it's just about pausing for a moment, taking that break, thinking about it in a very mindful manner, and then responding to it. And I think that really helps. And you know, things like, for example, yoga and meditation are great tools to sort of help in this journey, because what it does is it calms you down. It helps you to sort of focus better on the task at hand rather than the circumstances or the people or anything else, and then gives you that ability to take a decision in the right manner. And especially when you are treading unknown or uncharted territories and places. Again, any thoughts, questions on this? Otherwise, we can move to the next one.
No. Any questions, please type on the chat box. We can move, Rajesh.
All right. Which brings me to the third and the last one. So here again, this is something that, you know, I really believe that we all could do with a lot of, which is a lot of the fearless leaders constantly push themselves and also others out of their comfort zone. You know, we are all very comfortable operating in our own little spaces and doing stuff that we are used to doing. And the minute we again have to, you know, get out of the comfort zone is when we start becoming uncomfortable, right, so to speak. So, and I've seen that in several other leaders who I, you know, who are, you know, go beyond beyond this, and also in myself, in terms of the minute we are able to get out of our comfort zone and try something different, which we have never done before, what happens is two things. One, of course, we find that we are able to do it, right? And that happens because we learn along the way when we are able to do it. But more importantly, it's a very, very good virtuous cycle for generating further self-belief for us to expand our own circle of, you know, comfort. So then that starts becoming comfortable, and then you're able to move on to something else, which again is uncharted. So it then actually leads to a virtuous cycle, as opposed to the other case where the more uncomfortable and unwilling we are to tread to these spaces, the area of comfort starts shrinking. And then we are operating in a very, very silo kind of an environment, right? So I think that's another habit that would be very, you know, symbolic of fearless leaders. Again, I just like to talk about two examples. You know, when I joined Perfetti 6 years ago, I joined as general manager in Bangladesh, right? And when this opportunity came up, I've never been to Bangladesh in my life, and nor did I go on a recce trip to see how the places, how the countries, etc. So to me, it was a new company, new country, new culture, new role. I'd taken on the role of a general manager for the first time, and pretty much all variables were new, right? But the whole point was to say, okay, I mean, it sounds so exciting and challenging. I mean, one has looked at Perfetti from outside saying, great company with fantastic brands to work on. It seemed like a nice, interesting, challenging market to take on. And of course, the role was something which was very aspirational. And therefore, it was all about saying, let's go out there, explore, see what happens, experiment, learn from it, and grow. And I was fortunate and blessed to have a fantastic run out there, and subsequently I then moved to India, and here I am now running the business for India. So I think it's about constantly finding ways to get out of comfort zone, and as leaders also making sure that you push people out of the comfort zone, because very often what happens is people are also happy to be in comfort zone, and it's your job to do that. They might not like you for it at that point of time, but if you're able to do that, they see the, going back to the first point, the long-term benefit of it versus the short-term pain of it. And once they are able to see that, they'll appreciate you and thank you for that, because you are able to add some value to their growth as well. And on a personal level, Rashmi talked about it. You know, I've never trekked in my life, but 4 years ago, I got an opportunity. Somebody was going to the Everest base camp, and we got talking, and we said, why not? You know, I'm scared of heights, actually. I'm not very comfortable with high altitude, nor am I comfortable in flying in some of these small aircrafts in Nepal. But to me, it was a great opportunity to, you know, push myself out of comfort zone. And without having done any trek in my life, I just signed up for Everest Base Camp as the first trek. This was in 2016. It was one of the most amazing experiences in my life. 2 weeks of isolation, digital detox. I connected with various people. I connected with nature. It allowed me to, you know, discover, you know, self-belief in myself that I could do something like this. And the feeling when you hit base camp is something one cannot describe, which then prompted me to say that every year I would go on one trek to some interesting place. So the next year was Kilimanjaro, and this year was Annapurna Base Camp. So again, something which allowed me to discover myself, overcome. I wouldn't say that I'm still completely over my fear of heights and altitude, but it allows you to go forward in that journey. And in a way, it sort of provides you with those experiences, which, back to my earlier point, gives you the self-belief that you could do it. And then in a way, you also inspire others to do it, right? So yeah, those are a couple of examples I wanted to share on that.
This is also something, some sort of having a creative hobby, say a mountaineering or a trek that you've been going to. It is also some sort of a mindfulness. Would you say that? Because you talked about mindfulness in the previous slide.
Yeah, I think the mindfulness, so for example, just an anecdotal thing, right? When I was going on the Everest Base Camp trek, it was a 12-day trek. And I was thinking to myself, out of 13 people, I knew only one person. So the whole point was, and I was the oldest in the group. So I thought, you know, I need to carry a lot of music because I'm going to be walking around and I don't know anybody there. But at the end of 12 days, I did not listen to a single song. Yeah, because to me, it was the river Kosi flowing alongside. There was so much of, you know, nature to see and experience and hear. And there were so many interesting people to, you know, be in the present and make those conversations with. So I think absolutely some of, you know, having a passion, you know, I don't like the word hobby. Having something that you're passionate about really helps you to be in the present, be very mindful of what's going on around you. And in a way, it actually helps you to recharge and re-energize for the work that you do.
Yeah. Yeah, so, you know, that makes sense totally. You know, and you also forgotten to speak about your entire photography thing because you are an avid photographer. So that also is a big passion for you. So how do you manage photography, climbing mountains and also, you know, being a CEO? How do you do that?
Rashmi, I think it's about, to me, it's about, you know, making choices. Yeah, and everything is about trade-offs. We have finite time in our hands. And we need to really make choices. So, I started writing out my purpose statement and I try and do things which are aligned to the purpose statement. So, for example, if the choice was between watching television and working on a photography project, clearly the photography project wins. Or if it was a choice between, you know, doing some, watching a cricket match or, you know, doing something else versus going on a trek, it's the trek. So it would be good for us to all put down as to, you know, what are things that are important to us, what we value very dearly. And once you have that in place, I think there is always a way to make them happen where you are able to weave it into your daily schedule.
Yeah. So it's all about the choice. So there's a very interesting question from Shovik, who has written that, would you describe your decision of going for EBC trek as fearless? As for EBC trek, you must have some prior trekking experience and the decision you took is not recommended in the trekking world. How would you describe your decision since you said you did not have any experience in trekking before?
Yeah. Well, it would have been foolish if I had just gone, if somebody said I'm going to climb the Everest to the top, and if I had gone, I think that would have been foolish, right? But when I signed up, I had no idea and I had not trekked before, although I'm relatively fit. So I did, of course, read up and do some research on what it means and what it entails, etc. And to Shovik's point, did a good thorough check on, how it's going to be and how's that experience. But and therefore, I felt that that's something that I could do. The larger point I was making was not so much just to rush into something, but the point was, yeah, it seemed like a interesting enough thing to experience, which I thought would also help me get out of comfort zone. So it so happened that it was EBC. It could have been any other trek, for all you know.
Great. There's another question from Saurav, who says, what change or transformation did you observe in yourself post your trekking experience? And how would you relate to your success in every front?
Yeah, I think a few things. So one is, you touched upon it as well earlier, this whole thing of being mindful of the present, right? One of the things is that when you are on a trek, thankfully, most of the time there is no network. Yeah. So you don't, you're not distracted by your gadget and you're able to be very, very present to what's happening around you, whether it is being with nature, whether it is sitting down and chatting with some of your co-trekkers and so on and so forth. So I think that's one lesson I picked up, and I try and be much more mindful even in my day-to-day life when I'm not trekking. The other thing is around appreciating simplicity. You know, there are so many things that all of us take for granted. Yeah, when we are in our urban lives, saying things like electricity, clean water, good hot food on our table. All of these we just take for granted that we will get it, of course. But when you are out there in a trek, you realize that some of these things, people there don't take it for granted, and you cannot take it for granted. We have to have that sense of gratitude that we have all those things for us ourselves. And I think that's another thing which I've picked up over the years through some of these experiences. The third is, you know, this whole thing around materialistic stuff, right? You realize that when you're in a trek, you can do with a lot less than what you think you can do with. Whether it is food, I mean, the best food I've had in treks is the Nepali thali, which is, you know, rice, dal, and palak sabzi. So whether it is food, whether it is clothing, whether it is shelter where you stay, I think we make a much bigger deal out of all of this than what we really need. So I would say these are some of the lessons I've picked up, and I try and follow those in my daily life as well.
Great. So being mindful, appreciating simplicity, and also, you know, less being more, and understanding that we don't need everything around us. I think it's beautiful. And you've also been, you know, stressing about the entire point around choice.
Yeah.
So we are looking for more questions. So please do type in case you have any other questions on the chat box here. Okay, so there's another question which comes, which says, perhaps you could use some of your time management skills to be able to pursue a demanding passion. Job and a passion. That's Nancy from the team asking you.
You have all of us have various things to do, and I guess one of course is prioritizing, right? What is important to you, because it's not possible to do everything. And sometimes we also tend to take on too many things. At least I can speak for myself. I end up taking up sometimes more things than I can do. So one, that is a watch out. So, you know, being mindful of that and not taking on too much is an important thing. Second is, the prioritizing is definitely one. Third is if something is a passion, you will find a way to do it, right? And you will be able to make those choices and weave it into your this thing. So the other piece is around weaving some of these things into your daily routine. So for example, I'm passionate about fitness, and I believe that, you know, my level of fitness has a direct bearing on my work as well. So then if that is a question, then you would find a way to somehow weave it into your schedule. So for example, whenever I travel, one of the things that would always get packed is a pair of shoes. So even if I can't do any other form of fitness activities, the least I can do is wear my shoes and go for a half an hour walk. Yeah. So you would always be able to then find ways of integrating what you're passionate about into your daily routine in some way. And I think if you can manage that, half the battle is won.
Yeah, beautiful. I think it's all about, you know, sort of structuring yourself. If you want to, if you make a choice, then make it happen. So you will go all out to, you know, sort of do that. So we're still looking for questions. Okay, there's another question from Sumit Chaudhary. He's saying being vulnerable is indeed a key leadership trait. Still, many people tend to avoid or portray larger than life persona. Any instances where being vulnerable helped you be a better leader?
I can't think of specific examples, but for example, you know, I did the role in Bangladesh, and even when I joined that role, for example, I've been a marketing professional throughout. I'm a marketeer at heart, and that was my first general manager role. And like I said, it was new country, new place, new culture, new organization. and for a brief period, I didn't have a boss as well. So it was all about saying, okay, I am new to this place. I'm new to this country on all of it. I don't know anything. Let me figure out from first principles and start learning. So, I mean, I did various things. So whether it is talking to five other general managers or managing directors who I respect, I randomly reached out to them and said, look, I've now become one. Can you please tell me what are the things that I should look for, do's and some don'ts? Or, talking to my people and say, look, I'm not here to come and tell you what to do. I'm here to learn about the organization, learn about you guys and what we do, and then see if I can add value to it. So I think it's just about, being, I would fearless enough to say that, look, I don't know, right? I think that's very important. Or if sometimes you make a mistake, and I've made several mistakes in my career, having the ability to say, look, I made a mistake, I'm sorry about it, and, move on from there. So I think that's a very, very important thing, because that really also makes people respect for you go up. Because if you are able to display that vulnerability and humility, I think it makes you far more, a bigger leader than you were otherwise.
Yeah. I think it's beautiful, because if you're showcasing your vulnerability at the right time and people do understand where you're coming from, then you actually end up building a lot more relationship as well, which is more deeper and meaningful.
Absolutely.
So I've known you personally, and your relationship building skills are also very, very amazing across everywhere that you move around. So how do you do that also? Is that also, a part of your strategy in terms of, how you want to be, in terms of your values, et cetera? How do you do that?
Yeah. So, I think the good part for me is I like to connect with people, because as part of one of the values is relationship, and that matters. I think that's one. And the second is, I also realize that, when you connect with people, which is a key differentiator for human beings versus any other species, it also is a great way to learn, right? And learn and grow, because you feed off each other when you start having conversations on topics which are of common interest. So from both perspectives, I find it extremely good to connect with people. And so to that extent, I'm lucky that it comes a little bit more naturally to me.
So there's a very nice question which has come from Sohamji. He's saying, you have done trekking, photo shoot, and at the same time, you're also the MD of a number one confectionery company. Out of this, which assignment did you enjoy the most, or are you enjoying the most?
When you say assignment, I'm is that between trekking, photography, and my work? Is that the question?
Yeah.
No, I don't think I can pick this versus the other. I think the important thing is to enjoy what you do, right? So if I'm trekking, I absolutely enjoy the moment there, being there trekking. If I'm doing a photo shoot, I'm completely lost to the world and I'm focusing on that. And if I'm doing my job, I make sure that I do the job to the very best of my ability. So very difficult to pick this versus that. I think they are all equally important. They all feed off each other, and they all together make me what I am. So
I think your answer was itself, it's all being mindful. That is what you're saying. So you have to be mindful being, doing photography or doing trekking or doing your work. And that you've already mentioned. So I think it shows very clearly. So great. So any more questions? We are looking for more questions. We have Rajesh, Ramakrishnan, CEO and MD Perfetti here. People who have joined in late. Anything? So out of the first five values that you talked about, Rajesh, which was about vulnerability, authenticity, resilience, responsibility, and leading from the front, which do you think is the most difficult of the value to, sort of observe and work through?
That's a good question. Probably think the most difficult is vulnerability.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because there are also these notions, right? I mean, if you are a leader, you can't be seen as weak. If you are a leader, you have to be, a leader is a big guy or lady, courageous, who's brave, and so on and so forth. And that's the general way it's been portrayed over the years, right? So I think that in my opinion, probably that's a little bit of a tough one for many people.
And considering the fact that we've always been told, especially in a very patriarchal world where we're saying that, you know, don't show your emotions, especially men. You know, and especially women also, when you go to the top, you're not supposed to, because women are supposed to be more emotional. So they don't show your emotions. So I think it's a double bind out there.
Absolutely.
So there are a couple of questions again. So there's one question from Hema again, who's saying, who are your inspirations? If you can take that, then there is another question. Who are your inspirations? I mean, who inspires you?
See, I don't think it's one person, but, you know, I try and pick up some really interesting traits from different people. So in no particular order, I think definitely Rahul Dravid, as I was growing up and in the last few years, has been an inspiration. Just again, I mean, he does so much, but he's not one of those guys who's like, you know, beat my chest and talk about it in terms of being really sound, being very grounded, humble, vulnerable probably, and yet being rock solid in what he does. So he's an inspiration. I think Obama, I would say, is an inspiration in terms of, again, demonstrating vulnerability, solidity, compassion, authenticity. So yeah, these are some names that come to mind.
Great. So we have a question from S. Satyanarayanan. He says, what do you think about fear of facts? How to handle it, how to communicate and convince others on this fact which we fear? Fear of facts.
Fear of facts. I assume, is that fear of data? So I'm not sure what I understand the question correctly.
Any fact. He's saying any fact.
Fear of fact.
So I think truth, I think he means if there is a truth and...
Okay. So...
yeah, he's also saying truth.
Yeah, I'm just trying to understand exactly what it means. How do you handle truth? So I mean, if I understand one way to understand it is to say that if there is something which is a fact and you have to communicate that to people, which it might not be very palatable, that's one way to look at it. I'm not sure if that's what he meant, but if that's the case, I think it's really about, you know, being authentic in that and laying it the way it is. Because, you know, as a leader, you do find yourself in those kind of situations where you have to convey not necessarily very good news to people, whether it could be in your team, it could be above, and so on and so forth. And I've often found that the best way to do it is to be absolutely authentic, be transparent and straightforward in communicating the bad news in a very matter of fact and a factual manner, if that's to do with the business. But if it is to do with people and emotions, then you know, do it in a very empathetic manner and not a sympathetic manner, right? And I think if you are able to do that, to my mind, probably that's the best way to deal with it.
So authenticity moves across your entire way of functioning as well, and that we can also see.
Yeah.
There are a couple of more questions. So I will just run it quickly. We have just 4 minutes. So there's one question about trying to become a fearless woman becomes a double jeopardy at times. How to handle this? Then in the world of business complexity in day-to-day life, how do you manage personal and professional life? So let's take these two questions and then I'll take the rest.
Sure. Personal, professional life, I mean, I also think that, you know, in many ways, they are both intertwined, right? There is always, we talk about work and life balance, etc. But what I try and do is I try and weave things around my schedule. So, for example, if I have, you know, I have my daily fitness routine at 7 in the evening, I make sure that I leave office on time to do that from 7 to 8. But I also make sure that if there is any pending work that needs to be caught up on, I do that, say, between 9:30 and 10 in the night, right? Or whatever is required. So one of the things I found works well for me, and it's different strokes for different folks. So I'm not even suggesting that this is the only way to do it. But for me, if I am able to weave it into my schedule, I think that works better for me. Yeah. So then I'm able to then seamlessly move from getting my work done and making sure that I do the other stuff that I love as well. Similarly, when I'm working on a photography project, I'm thinking about it most of the time. So for example, if I'm walking during my morning walk, I'm thinking of the idea and what I want to do with it. But obviously I use the weekends, which I could have put to maybe some other use to do the physical shoot for the project and so on and so forth. So I think if you're able to, again, going back to the earlier point, make some choices and you really identify which are those things which are important to you, matter to you, then there is always a way to find, sort of weave it into your routine. Yeah.
So this question, I'm sure it's come from Annie, which says that, you know, we're talking about fearless leadership, but how to become a fearless woman? Because there's so many double jeopardies that we are supposed to be handling as women. How do you handle that? What is your...
That's a great question. I'm not sure I'm very qualified to answer that question. But I think, unfortunate truth is that in our society, the way it is structured, and in India particularly, this whole fearless woman, is looked at in different contexts. And there are these practical considerations around us in the world outside, which also in a way makes it difficult. Although I feel that that's changing to a large extent now. So I personally think the fundamentals of whatever we spoke about in the last 1 hour, they don't change. I think they are as applicable to men as to women. It's just that for women, there are other considerations to keep in mind. And the good news is a lot of focus is going on that as well now. And hopefully that helps us to overcome some of these stereotypes and myths which exist, which help women to shine even more than now.
Yeah. And of course, there is also this entire support from all the men as well inside the organization.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah.
Okay. So then there are final two questions. First one is, can you share one incident of difficult situation in your career and how you have overcome it? And second question is, we discussed about proactive space and composed mindful response. How can we effectively bring in us, in our team and in our organization?
Yeah, so I'll take the second one first. Proactive space, we spoke about it in mindful response. It's really about, working with our teams to not very impulsively respond to things, right? Because like I said, when we are faced with something which is uncomfortable or faced with something which causes fear in us, we are programmed biologically and chemically to either fight back or run away or get into a non-action mode. And if you are able to train our people, work with them to say that, look, if we are faced with this kind of a thing, let's take a pause moment. Let's look at it in a little bit more dispassionate manner. Take a few deep breaths maybe, and then really try and find how to work around it. I think over a period of time, it becomes a habit like anything else, like brushing your teeth, right? So it's just about that. And like I said, for me, things like yoga, things like meditation have really helped in that, because it just evens your pace of breathing. It evens the way you respond to external stimulus and so on and so forth.
Okay. One incident of difficult situation in your career and how you overcome it.
I spoke of the Chennai strike. I think that's a great example of, what happened and how we, keeping in mind some of the things we spoke about, we were able to overcome that.
Okay. So, thank you, Rajesh. In fact, we are closing on time. I think the 3-4 things that have come out from our session today is your entire stress around mindfulness in, sort of running across everything. Of course, vulnerability as a value that you sort of have been putting across all your ways of doing work, and especially also on your passion, etc. And of course, this entire thing about your 3 habits, which is about long-term thinking and proactiveness and pushing the boundaries. And it's been a great session for us, for you candidly sharing your thoughts and your stories. Thank you so much. Any last comment that you would want to give, and then we will close the session.
Thank you so much for having me on this. It's been a very interesting conversation. And Nikita, if you move to the next slide, my only message to everybody would be, just go take the leap and magic can happen. Thank you.
Yeah, and if you want to get in touch with Rajesh, he has his own website, www.rajesh-ramakrishnan.com. He is also available on the email mentioned here. And you can also follow him on Instagram at Rajesh_photo. So thank you, Rajesh. Thank you so much. And thank you, all the participants.
Thank you, participants.
We had about 80, 85 people joining in today. So thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Rashmi. And thanks to everybody. And good luck for the next year. Thank you.
Happy New Year. Thank you.